Yo, yo, what's up? It's your boy Lyrics, Lyrics from the 559 Podcast. Slap on the beat. It's the homie DeMar, man. Clear Music Productions. Who produced that, man? Let me know, man, if I should change up the intro or if I should just keep this beat or what. Let me know. Oh, man, I've been in a lot of pain, man. My shoulder's been killing me, man. I don't know if you guys use CBD, but, man, that stuff works pretty good. I just bought some the other day. I'm not going to give out no name or anything because it's not like they sponsor me. But, hey, man, CBD stuff, man, if you got that cream, wear it. I mean, put it on. It works. Hey, check this out, man. Have you guys watched that Selena, Yolanda, and The Secret Between Them documentary? It's crazy. There's a lot of stuff on that. There's a lot of stuff I didn't know. I think there was one that they were talking about where how Selena had an affair with the doctor. And he, I guess in 2012, he came out saying, yeah, they were in love. I never heard about that. Didn't know about it. I guess that lady Yolanda, man, just kind of trying to clear up her side of the story. Like she admit that she murdered or she killed Selena, but like accidental or whatnot. But she's trying to clear up the whole thing about like how she got fired, how she was writing checks, but there's like more into the story with proof and all that stuff. So anyway, man, I guess they're just trying to I don't know, maybe because she's about to get released next year, and so she's hoping that nobody comes after her or something like that, just trying to just share her side of the story. It's kind of crazy, man. I don't know, man. I mean, you still did what you did, you know. And then, yeah, she admitted that and stuff, but she was saying that was accident or what, it was an accident. I don't know, man. Like, I wonder, man, is she like psychotic or what? Is she crazy? Like, is she just coming up with these stories? I mean, what she's saying, are they facts? I mean, ah, man. But you know what's so cool, though? I get to interview somebody, man, who is a therapist. And maybe she watched the documentary. I don't know. But right now, I'm going to introduce you to Sonia. How's it going?
Hey, Lyrics. It is going well. I'm happy to be here with you, chatting.
Oh, man, I'm happy to get you on. Really am. Yeah, so, hey, I was just talking right now about this whole Selena and Yolanda. Have you watched it, the Selena and Yolanda? It's called And the Secrets Between Them, and it's a documentary. Have you watched that?
You know what? I have not seen it. I've heard a couple of people talk about it, and that's going to be next on my list. Yeah. I have not seen it. Have you?
Yeah, no, I did. There's like two episodes, and I just finished watching it on Peacock. Basically how just Yolanda just telling her side of the story and stuff and making it sound like, you know, her killing Selena was like basically accidental, and so everything that they talked about Yolanda was like how the public already made her guilty. Like, they didn't even get I guess she's trying to say they didn't give her an opportunity to explain her side of the story, you know. I don't know. They're saying, because, you know, they said she got in trouble for like embezzlement, but she was never arrested for that, you know. And so it kind of goes all into that, like Selena's dad, how like Selena's dad was out to get her, how her tires were slashed, how her brakes were cut off, how men were following her. They beat her up in the bathroom, and Selena knew that.
Goodness, yeah, that Selena,
she had bought a gun because of that reason, only because of that reason. And Selena talked to her about, hey, man, you don't need a gun. So she ended up taking the gun back, but she ended up buying it the second time. And then that's kind of like how everything went, where Selena goes into the hotel, and so she kind of puts the gun to her head like she's going to commit suicide, and then Selena walks away, and that's when she kind of like flipped out and shot her. So she was just basically like accidentally, like just like, hey, where you going, type of thing, whatever, boom, and just shot her.
Oh my god.
And
so,
and they were saying like there was like somebody that said, they pointed the gun at her outside and said something, hey, something, bitch, and then shot her. And they were saying that that's not true, but I don't know. That's crazy. But and then so she just kind of like telling her story about, like, you know, just her side of the story, basically. But she's not saying that she didn't kill her. Like, she knows she killed her. It happened. But she said, like, that was her friend. She didn't mean to do that at all. So I don't know. I don't know if that's like, you know, you being a therapist, like, I mean, I don't know if you ever experienced anything like that or heard about people that are just like psychotic, like they're just crazy and they just, I don't know, like they believe in their story
There's a lot of psychopaths, you know, like people with NPD, like narcissistic personality disorder. They can be pretty evil. You know, very manipulative. I can't say for sure with Yolanda. Now I have to watch it. I'm totally going to watch it now because, like, you really got me interested in it because I think everyone should have, you know, should be able to share their side of the story.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But, again, she might need some money and...
And that too. And you know what's crazy? Because I was bringing this up to somebody at work, a few people at work, and somebody goes, man, it sounds like you kind of like, not like you believed her, like she kind of like you, she got your attention, like you kind of. And I said, you know what? I don't want you to think that I, because when I first heard the trailer where she was like, you get to listen to my side of the story type of thing. And it was like, like what the heck? What side do you, you killed her. Why do we need to listen to your side anyway? And that's how I was feeling. So I, you listen to both sides, but the only people that know the truth is them. And it's sad because Selena's not here to share her side of the story. So it's not like I'm on anybody's side or whatever. The fact I love Selena, like that was, you know, of course I was like our Madonna or Michael Jackson whatever, you know, like
I remember when their movie came out, like, oh my gosh, it was like the big thing, you know, I wanted to go watch Selena. Do you remember that?
Yeah with Jennifer Lopez. I thought it was a great movie. And you know what, later on finding out that you know, she could have still be here. She could have been alive still, from what I understand. I know they didn't say this in the documentary, but I did have a friend that knows the family, and because of their religion, they're Jehovah's Witness. So a lot of them don't believe in blood transfusion, right? Am I saying that right?
Blood transfusions.
Yeah. So they could have kept her alive, right? But because of being Jehovah's Witness, they were not going to do that. From what I understand, that was left out.
You are just schooling me on Selena. You are very invested in it because, I mean, I loved her. You know what I find fascinating right now as you share this, though, that how so many people are probably very interested in hearing Yolanda's side, even though Selena was so loved.
Right.
So I find that interesting at this time.
Right. Yeah, no, it is, you know, and I know a lot of people could be like, oh, I'm not going to support it or what, but think about it, man. We live in a world of, like, people want to know these bad things. They want to know what happened. They're not going to pass this up. They're going to, I mean, even if she started her own show or, you know, people are going to tune in. Like, that's just the way it is. This is our world today. They feed into like, bad videos. They
the make negativity. Comedy.
People love
and
that
it's so
stuff.
Negative, right? It like brings people down. I'm like, you know, that's a big reason why I hardly watch TV, to be honest with you. Or the news. Oh my gosh, I cannot watch the news.
Yeah, I know. I can't stand the news. You know what? The news gives me anxiety. I don't know about you, but for me, just, oh man, like, especially when I have the TV on, I think I'm hearing it when I'm sleeping and I'm having these bad dreams and I'm waking up to something negative and my day is just like, ugh.
Oh, no, I used to watch news a lot. Like, I was very kind of like political, like maybe when, I think it was like, what was the year when Hillary ran against Trump?
Yeah.
Right?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, during that time, like, I would watch a lot of news and really, it would just piss me off. So I'm like, okay, I need to stay away from this. This is, like, not feeding me well, you know? So, but, yeah, you really have me, like, ooh, I'm drawn into watching that story, that documentary now about Yolanda.
Yeah, I mean... Yeah, whoever's listening to this, I'm not trying to say I'm siding with her. What I'm just breaking down what why she's doing this. She could be in it for the money. I mean, or she's scared of her life where she knows that she's gonna get out next year, and she's hoping that people are not just gonna go after her right away. Like, hey, listen to me. That's probably what's going on. It's a little bit of everything. I don't know. I'm just telling you what I watch, and I'm like, wow, like. This is crazy.
A little bit of everything.
Yeah, you know, and it's sad, you know, how they said, oh, yeah, she was having affairs and this and that. Like, you know, like.
So who was having an affair?
Selena was with the doctor, or, you know, and then I guess in 2012, wow, that's when that doctor said, we were in love, and there's like little letters or whatever, and so yeah, it's pretty crazy.
A lot of little twists and turns to this. Now I had no idea.
And I'm telling people, like, look, don't believe what I'm saying or what you heard. I mean, all that could still be lies, you know what I mean? Don't you know, it's this is the thing. This is what we're feeding off of right now. And then we're gonna play that telephone game. What is it? I'm gonna tell you something, and you're gonna go tell somebody else. It's gonna come out a little bit different. And then there goes all these rumors and gossips and stuff like that. So, but you know, yeah, man.
That's how it works. Yeah.
But hey, Con Amor, your therapist friend, I appreciate you interviewing me. That was pretty fun, and you got me to say a lot of things, and I wasn't really prepared to say on a podcast, but I'm glad it was told, because there's somebody out there that's, you know, ready to hear it and that needs to hear it.
You know what? My brother, my younger brother, I have two brothers, an older one and a younger one, and they're very, not religious, they're Christian, you know, they're very good dudes, really good dudes. And
yeah,
my younger one, my brother Emmanuel, he's like, hey, I heard that one you did with lyrics. I loved it.
So oh, he heard awesome.
It. Yeah, I knew he would,
yeah,
you know, but I think thank you for coming on.
Yeah.
It was wonderful to have you speak and just share about your book and, you know, just everything you do.
Yeah, no problem. Like, and so if anybody wants to listen to it, it's called Con Amor, Your Therapist Friend, correct?
Yes. So that's our podcast. And it's me and my co-host. Her name is Nenya de Leon Figueroa. She's a licensed marriage and family therapist. And it was actually her husband's idea. You know, he was, he grew up in LA, and he had brought it up because he would always ask her, you know, and obviously his wife being a therapist, she mm-hmm. would, you know, share tips and explain things to him and kind of break things down to him that he didn't understand. So he encouraged her. He's like, you know what? There's nothing out there like this. You should start a podcast, you know, like in Spanish and English, just talking about mental health topics, but you guys are doing it as friends. And so
right.
she went with it. She asked me, she had asked me like once, two times, like it had been a year. And then finally, like a year later, I was like, okay. She asked me the third time and we did it. And I'm so glad we did.
Yeah.
Kind of, because it's been such an awesome experience to collaborate with people and to get good information out there to our Latina community.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Especially in Spanish and English.
Yeah.
Information on mental health, just creating more awareness.
Right.
So
I like it. I think you guys should do it maybe like separately. I could be wrong. I don't know. Like maybe like one Spanish podcast and one is just English. There was a friend that I work with that really needed to hear somebody like, you know, like you guys and stuff. And when I shared the podcast, he was like, oh, these are like mainly like in Spanish. But it was like looking for the right one that could she relate to, but just in English. You know what I mean? And okay. So, it would be cool if you guys would separate it. I don't know.
We do have it. Every episode we recorded in English and in Spanish.
Oh, okay. So you just got to read it then, huh? You got to read the description or how do you guys?
Yeah, you do. You got to read the description. But like with you, we're actually, I actually asked Young Beeves, because he's also a creative and he's a comedian. And so I think he's going to be doing the Spanish version of it, you know, because we recorded the Using Creativity for Healing with You.
Got you.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So now we were like, oh my gosh, we need the Spanish one for our Spanish listeners. So yeah, if you go on there, you'll see that every episode, like on inner child healing, there's a Spanish one and then there's an English one.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Okay. That's how you're breaking it down. Okay.
Yes. Yeah. And you know what? The ones we release first are actually the Spanish ones, just to kind of, we just wanted to honor like our Spanish speaking community. You know what I mean?
100%.
Because, yeah, there's a lot of just, you know, information lacking out there about things that we go through. So.
Right. And you know what? And we didn't even talk about like why I didn't know Spanish. Remember we're like, we should talk about like how, why you don't know it. And it was because, you know, there's like a reason why, you know, because I wasn't raised.
There is.
Oh, did
That's really good though, Jaime, because people don't really talk about that.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I think sometimes people, Hispanic, Latinos, they feel embarrassed. Like, no, I don't know Spanish. You know, like, no, my parents didn't teach it to me. I don't know if that's something you experience.
Yeah, yeah. No, I mean, I get people that, got people tell me like, hey, how do you not know Spanish? You're Mexican. Yeah. And they're telling me this in Spanish. It's like, no, I understand more than what I speak. And it's like, but it was like, how do I explain why I don't know it? It was just, there's a story behind it. Like all my brother and my sisters, they know it, but it was because where I was raised with my aunt and uncle, you know, from my, you know, my mom passing at the age of eight, you know, eight days old, you know? So and I wish, you know, but hey, man, like there's some TV series in you know, that I filmed in Mexico where it was all my lines were in Spanish, you know, or there were some movies I did where I did have some Spanish. So, you know, with that, I hope somebody in my family or somebody that watched my movie or what, they could be like, man, like that's pretty good. Or like, man, I don't know, like something
that's
I could kind of
so
give
awesome.
Back.
But you know what I want to say? I want to say to you and to other people out there, Hispanic who don't know Spanish, like, don't be ashamed of it. You know, don't be ashamed. It happens. Like you said, there's a story behind it for everyone. There's, you know, sometimes like it just wasn't, you weren't immersed in it. And so it's like, you know, you don't learn it as well. So there's a lot of people like that. And I do notice that they feel kind of embarrassed at times. And it's like, no need.
Right. Well, that's good to know. Yeah, that's good. Yeah, nobody should feel embarrassed of that at all. Sonia, where are you from?
Well, I was born in, I'm from Pomona.
Oh, okay.
I was born in literally Pomona Valley Hospital. Pomona, that's in LA County. Do you know where that's at?
No, but I hear that a lot, especially from Fly Inc., right? Yeah.
Yeah.
I know he's from out there, right?
Yeah, so Pomona, that's where I grew up. I went to school there in Pomona. I went to Simons and went to Gary. Graduated from Gary. I was very, very involved in school. So that was like, that was really helpful for me, I think, growing up. Because growing up in Pomona, like, I grew up in the hood.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like, if you knew where I lived, it's like literally the corner of Olive Street and Park Avenue. And so it was very, very busy. You know, cars would go by there a lot. There was a lot of gang members around, a lot of gang activities, you know, a lot of gun shooting. You didn't know if it was hardly ever fireworks. It was more like gunshots. So, I mean, that's the kind of environment that I did grow up in. I was raised by my mom, my dad. My dad left pretty early. My dad was an alcoholic, so he wasn't around very often. He was very, very absent. He came from Mexico. And when he came here, he struggled a lot with anxiety, with depression, with just trying to adjust to, you know, doing life in the United States. And he struggled. So he was an absent father, really. Loved my dad. You know, he passed away. He's been gone for some time now, but love him. And I'm so thankful for, you know, for him, even though it wasn't the greatest, you know, he wasn't the greatest dad. I understand. Yeah. I understand why he wasn't, you know. So my mom really, held it together, you know, because it was four of us.
Yeah.
And so she raised us as a single mom. We grew up on public assistance, you know, so we were pretty poor, you yeah. know, like barely making ends meet. But my mom was awesome, you know, she made it happen. She made it work for us.
Yeah.
She would take us to church every Sunday, mm. like single mom. She'd take us to church every Sunday. We were raised, well, I was raised Catholic. Later on, when I got to college, I started just really expanding my spirituality and kind of seeking elsewhere. But
yeah.
My mom was awesome. Yeah, that's how where I grew up. And then in high school, that's when I got pregnant. I was a teen mom. So I was 16 years old when I got pregnant.
Okay.
With my first.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. Crazy, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, no, I mean, it happens even out here. It's everywhere.
Yeah. You know what's funny? Well, it's not funny, and I don't encourage this, but yeah. I was class president all 4 years in my high school. And so, you know, my last year, it was, I got a lot of people talking about me because I was pregnant.
Yeah.
Here's your class president. She's pregnant. Yeah. So, wow. Yeah, that was something.
Wow.
But we live and we learn.
Yeah. And how does your child now? Like, you know, I bet your child is doing great and doing amazing things, right?
You know what? She is. So I have four daughters, right? Because that one I had when I was young, my oldest, her name is Mary Jane, and we call her MJ. She's like, oh my gosh, my baby. She's 28 years old.
Yeah.
You know what, Lyric? She's actually a psychotherapist too.
Wow.
Yeah, she is she's not licensed yet, but she is a therapist. So she's collecting her hours right now. And, she sings. She's so talented. She's a good kid. She got married. Yeah. She has a great husband. So, dude, as a mom,
yeah.
What else can I ask for?
Yeah. Okay. So, was your mom mad that you? I mean, come on. And of course, right? Being pregnant at 16, and you named her Mary Jane. Was she mad?
Hey, Mary Jane. That's funny, right? I love that name.
I do
really
too.
I was so like, it was her dad, right? Her dad really wanted the name, and I thought, okay, I guess, you know, it's a beautiful name, right. And I love the song, and so, but yeah, she's gotten so much for, you know, having that name, but when I got pregnant, it was, it was pretty sad. I was given an ultimatum, like, my mom basically said, you can leave. You can go and live with him and be with him and go. If you're going to be with him, you need to leave and you need to, like, he needs to take care of you.
Right.
But if you're not going to be with, if you want to stay here, you can't see him because, you know, he's not going to have it easy. Like, he just got you pregnant and and he's going to come and visit whenever he wants and not be responsible, you know, not, you know, take responsibility for, you know, his actions or whatever.
Yeah.
So I was like, well, first of all, I'm what, 16? So I'm like, oh my God, what do I do with this?
Yeah.
What do I do? You know, so obviously I'm like, well, shit, I have to stay with him. You know, I'm having a baby.
Right.
Like, what am I supposed to do? So there I go. So I left. Mm. So it was my senior year in high school. So sad. I still remember my little brother's face.
Yeah.
You know, he was like so saddened, but yeah, so that's what happened, and that relationship didn't go so well.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that was an abusive relationship. I ended up leaving him, and that was a really good thing because it was like physically verbal abuse.
Yeah.
So.
Wow.
Yeah, that was hard. That was a really challenging time. That actually. I actually had post-traumatic stress disorder for quite some time.
Wow.
After that. I think like a lot of people, right, when they go through abuse or different crises or different traumas, get affected and we don't even realize, you know, we're walking around with PTSD or other stuff. And so,
100%. Yeah. I think I mentioned that too on your show. It's like you're older and you realize, like, man, like, why do I have anxiety and depression? Where is this coming from? And then you look back and it's like, oh, okay, this makes sense on why. And you are a psychotherapist. And what is a psychotherapist?
So we are licensed to provide mental health therapy. Mm-hmm. Essentially, yeah. So I specialize in all mental health, and then so when we talk about mental health, we're talking about, you know, depression, anxiety, even schizophrenia. We're talking about the different personality disorders, but we're also talking about regular stress, you know, and like relationship issues, divorce, financial issues, changes, like, so that's what I do.
Wow. Man, I had a lot of that.
I help people navigate all of that.
Mm. And you know, that's good. Like I said on your show, I was like, man, maybe I should have took some, you know, maybe psychotherapy, you know, that would have had help, you know. But like I said, during the whole COVID time, and, you know, I just had a lot of thinking, a lot of time to myself, and just that stress, that anxiety, that depression, and the high blood pressure, all that just kind of slowly just went away. You know, like, why am I even tripping about anything? We're all going through a hard time right now. People are passing, and, you know, just so it's like, man, like, why am I so stressed over my job? Like, I you know, I think about stuff like that. Like, you could die tomorrow, and you could be easily replaced the next day. You know,
but you know what? I think it's so awesome. You've already gotten to that place, right?
Yeah,
where you don't worry anymore. But there's so many people who haven't crossed that, and they need help navigating it and getting to that other side.
Yeah,
because they're so stressed out, like they're just constantly worried. There's no peace.
Yeah, right.
So it's nice when we can get to that place.
Yeah, and how can these people get, in, you know, get to that place? How can they? How do they get therapy?
Well, I think if anybody is seeking therapy, I mean, obviously, if you have insurance, you call your insurance and you ask for a list of providers.
Mm.
Okay,
right.
Like, which is so, you know, it's. I'm like, my mind gets blown where, like, there's sometimes nurses who don't even know how to look for a therapist. And I'm like, if a nurse doesn't know how to look for a therapist and how to navigate the mental health system, how are regular people going to do it? You know what I mean?
Right.
It's like, so thank you for asking that question.
Yeah, no problem.
It's like, if you have Medi-Cal, if you have whatever insurance you have, you call your provider and you ask them for a list of providers in your area, and you reach out that way and you ask for an assessment, you know, and what will happen is they'll assess you and, you know, come up with some treatment goals, and then you just kind of go from there. I know it's awkward, right, for some people to make that step and want to open up their problems to some, like, random stranger. What do you think about that?
Okay, yeah, so, I mean, I want to say that I did speak to somebody before, and it's been so long ago, and I just felt like he wasn't listening. It was a place called Kingsview where I live at, and all he did was prescribe me some medication, right? It was just,
that
medicine got me feeling like a zombie.
Oh no! Okay, so I'm so sorry that I had you feeling like a zombie. First of all, but see, that's where you know, we need like a lot of psychoeducation in it. Yeah. But so. If you went to someone who prescribed you medication, that is not a psychotherapist.
Oh, I don't know.
That is a psychiatrist.
Oh, man.
Yeah, because the psychiatrist is the one who's going to prescribe medications. Psychologists, psychotherapists, we don't prescribe medications. I mean, we know a lot about them, but we don't prescribe them.
Oh, okay. I don't know where I signed myself at. I was young. I was like, I swear to you, I was like 19, 20 years old or something. So
you poor thing. Don't tell me they tried to give you medication for like ADHD.
No, it was like, man, what did they give me? Prozac, and they gave me, I think it was that, and then something else. It was like an upper and a lower, and it was like, Oh my gosh! All I know is like I could not function, and the doctor called me up and like how's everything going? I said not good. This medication is making me feel like I wanted to kill myself. Like I feel depressed even more. Well, take it for 2 weeks, and let your body get used. I said no, you take it for 2 weeks. I'm not taking this medicine, and I'm not seeing you no more. Like, and no.
Oh my goodness, side effects. I mean, your doctor should have told you about side effects, but it sounds like he told you to keep taking it.
Yeah, well, go ahead.
No, I actually have a medication story.
Oh, okay.
Do you want to hear it?
Yeah.
So after my last child, Ava, I got really bad postpartum depression. Like, I couldn't function anymore.
Oh, wow.
It was my last... I had like one last quarter, I think, of grad school to finish my master's degree, and I had to take a leave of absence. It was the saddest freaking thing ever, because I just needed one more quarter to graduate with my cohort, but I couldn't. Like, I couldn't. I just couldn't get up from my bed, and it hit me really, really bad. I had also been drinking during that time, which, again, I've been sober for over 11 years, but that's a side thing. But so when I got that depressed, I was like, oh my God, I need to get up. I need to function. I have kids. Like, I already stopped school. Like, what is happening to me? So I went and I saw a psychiatrist, and they were able to get me on medication. They gave me Zoloft. And that first day I took it, oh my God, it made me feel even more depressed.
Yeah.
I'm not saying this to scare people. I want you guys to listen to me, though. Like, it made me feel really, really depressed. But because I know and I have a background in this, I know that that wasn't going to be good for me, because medication, like, when it has side effects, should be kind of manageable. Like, you might get nauseated, you might get a headache, but it's still manageable, and that eventually goes away. But when it's really bad side effects like that, I'm like, no, this is not going to work. So right away I called. I'm like, okay, this is not working. It's making me feel worse. So that next day they prescribed a different medication.
Oh, wow.
And then that medication, it started making me feel better. But the next day I had like really extremely horrible bad stomach pains. And I'm like, oh, well, dang, well, this is not it either. So I called again. I'm like, nope, this is not going to work. So then finally, it was a third medication that was finally able to help me. And I was able to be on that, and it helped me, and I was able to get back up and finish school. I was on it for some time, and then I was able to wean myself off. But it was a lifesaver for me during that time.
Oh, wow.
So it's like...
So is that what made you become a therapist? That's how it started, or...?
No, I'll tell you what made me become a therapist. Being a survivor of domestic violence myself, I actually... it was all... I'm sure it was all God. God always had a plan from the very get-go, but...
There you go.
My best friend actually said, hey, there's a job here. And it was at a domestic violence shelter. And I was looking for a different job at that time. And so I applied and I started working there. I think I was 24 years old. So like well over 20 years ago. Mm. And I started working there as a bilingual housing advocate. So what I would do is I would help the women who would go in there with their children. I would interview them, and then I would help them find housing, like really inexpensive housing, and then we would move them in. And because the moms and their children had just experienced really tough times. So when I was working there, I would interview the women in English and Spanish, and I fell in love with hearing their stories and assessing and just wanting to help. So it was right there. That's where I was like, okay, I know what I want to be now. And that's when I went back to school. I got my bachelor's degree in human services. And then after that, I got a master of social work. And then I got licensed.
That's so cool.
And then more recently, 2 years ago, I became specialized in brain spotting.
What's that?
Oh my goodness. Brain spotting. I've become so passionate about it. It's a body brain based technique. Mm-hmm. It's a type of therapy technique. And the motto of brain spotting basically says that your own body and brain has its ability to heal itself. The other motto is like, where you look affects how you feel. And so essentially I'm using your field of vision, and then I use a little pointer, and then we're able to really get to deep-rooted trauma that a lot of the times we've blocked out.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? So it really goes more deeper into the subconscious, and it helps. It gives you more insight, more clarity, more solutions into what you need to do in the moment. It's really beautiful.
Yeah,
I've witnessed so many, like, you know, healing sessions where I do it, and I'm just like blown away. It's such a beautiful technique.
What do you think about, like, therapists who use, like, I don't even know what they call them, but people will take shrooms and they'll have a therapist.
Yeah.
Like, and I heard, like, with shrooms, just basically, like, it restarts your brain. That's, I'm telling people, like, don't take that, don't use it or nothing. Like, but I'm just asking you because I heard there's something like that.
Yeah, there is. It's like ketamine treatment, and they do also like plant medicine, mushrooms. They do different dosing, even like with cannabis, right? Different dosings of that. And
but it'd be more like a microdose, right?
Yeah. With mushrooms, it would be definitely more of a microdose. And I actually believe in it. I'm a strong believer in it. I may get like certified to be part of like accompany people who are going through the process, because again, I think it gets to areas of the brain,
right,
trauma, you know, that has been stuck. And yeah, I think it can be helpful.
Yeah, but I mean, you have to
obviously
be
supervised, like, not just
yeah, I was gonna say something. You have to be with somebody, right? Not with just anybody.
No, not just with anybody. Like, yeah, no, it has to be supervised. Like, you know, there's a lot of people who go and they want to try ayahuasca, right? Have you heard of that?
No, I have not.
Oh, wow. Yeah, you'll have to look it up. It's alternative, like, just healing methods too. But it's like you drink it, and it's kind of like you go through a dark night of the soul, and you confront like your darkest parts of yourself. And then it goes deep. It's kind of like a trip, I mean, I've never done acid, and I've never done mushrooms, but how people have explained it, I mean, it kind of sounds like that.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of healing also that happens in that. So yeah, there's a lot of different healing techniques out there.
Yeah, no.
I don't recommend ayahuasca, but that's just me.
Yeah, no. And, you know, I do have another question. Like, what do you recommend people to do when they face anxiety and depression other than just go to therapy? I'm just saying that because some people can't afford a therapist. Some people may not have insurance. What tips can you give someone who is facing depression and anxiety?
First and foremost, right, like, knowledge is power. So educate yourself.
Yes.
Like, go and read up on the symptoms of depression. What are the symptoms of depression? What are the symptoms of anxiety? And then what can you do? You know, there's a site called Therapist Aid.
Yeah.
And I get so many of my worksheets from there. And it talks about, like, dealing with anger, dealing with anxiety, CBT. And it gives a bunch of, like, different worksheet with information. So that's a really good resource, but I would say really kind of educate yourself on what it is. And with anxiety, just know that anxiety is like a liar, right? It comes in and it lies to us, and it says, you're not good enough, you're not this, blah, blah, blah. Right? It's like a negative, just like playing.
Well, the definition of that would be a feeling of fear, correct? And and that's what I like to say, like, this is what the devil likes to put in your mind, like, be scared of this, be scared of that. When you have where God's more like, hey, don't lack that faith. You know, have faith in me. Everything's going to be all right. You know,
do not fear. Like, how many times does he say that in the Bible, right? Like, do not fear. There's so many times in there. And I think there's a reason why it was put in there. Do not fear. Because like, in this world, we were going to come across a lot of things, and we were going to be under influences of other things. And we were going to be like spiritually attacked with a lot of fear.
Yeah.
There's so many people walking around in fear, right? And like you said, what is it? It is anxiety.
And you know, it's true. And you know what, Sonia, I would be that one person. It's in the Bible too, but I would always be that one person where I would worry about tomorrow. Because that's one scripture in the Bible, and I believe in Matthew's, where it says,
it is.
Let tomorrow worry about itself. But I would always worry about what's going to happen the next day. And you know, oh, my God, I hate that feeling.
And you know what? That's another good technique, right? With, like, people being able to practice affirmations. You know, when people are spiritual, I always love to use people's spirituality. You know, like, hey, there's affirmations in the Bible. Like, go and repeat them over and over and wash your brain with that, with the goodness, you know, with good words, with good stuff. Because then that's what you'll feel and that's what you'll put out.
Yes.
But... you know, there's a lot of, you know, I told you about news. I don't watch a whole lot of TV. I like to read a lot, but that's one of the reasons. It, like, really lowers your vibration.
Yeah. You know, it really
does. Been around low vibrating, like, humans, right? You feel it.
Right. 100%. 100%.
So, yeah. I mean, I'm trying to think of other things. Here's another thing, anxiety. Like, I remember when I went to my very first drug alcohol counselor, and I was so nervous, and it was a man, and he was like, "Are you okay?" I was anxious. I had, like, really bad anxiety. I thought I was gonna have, like, a panic attack in there. And he's like, very matter of fact, he's like, "Are you okay?" And I'm like, "No, I have a lot of anxiety." He's like, "Get up, jump around, you want to go for a walk?" I was like, but it really kind of snapped me out of it in the moment, because when you think of anxiety, a lot of it is excess energy, energy of fear or energy of worry. You know what I mean?
Yes.
And so when we have a lot of energy, we can move around. Yes. We could go for a run. We could go for a walk. We could start dancing in our room, in our living room. You know, there's a lot of different outlets that we can do. We can do yoga, breathing techniques. There's a really easy, quick, deep, focused breathing technique that I love, where you inhale through your nose for 4 seconds and then you hold it for 2 seconds.
It works. I tried it.
And then you exhale out your mouth for 8 seconds, and it helps. And they're little things, right, that we forget, because they're so easy. It's like breathing, but we forget.
And as we're talking about this, I'm just realizing, like, man, I've changed so much. I came a long way is what I'm trying to say. Like,
That's awesome. You're recognizing where you were before and kind of like where you're at now with anxiety.
Yeah, because all I did was stress for no reason, anxiety for whatever, and then depression. Now I'm like, man.
So how'd you do it?
I'm so.
How did you do it?
I mentioned in your podcast, it was like through COVID, you know, and all that was going on. Everybody was now how did I say it?
It's almost like everyone was now at your level.
Living my world now. Everybody's living in my world now. Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's how I felt. And that's the only
You weren't the
way.
Only one.
Yeah.
There's a lot of people who were feeling that way at that time, I remember.
That's so crazy. A lot of time, you know, just thinking and why worry, why stress, why, you know, just be blessed, you know, don't worry about the next day, like, God's in control. It's just a little bit of all that, just me telling me all that, telling myself that. But
it took practice, right?
Yes.
It took practice and a repetition of over and over again. I think people sometimes will stop because they're like, this is not working. They want change really fast. And it doesn't happen, like, real good change doesn't happen like that fast.
And then just listening to my own conversation when I was on TikTok and talking about my life and how someone said they were ready to commit suicide. You know, I had a few people tell me that. And then they will tell me, I'm so glad that I'm listening to your lyrics, because I don't know where I would be at tomorrow. I think it would have been over for me, you know.
Yeah.
And just to know that my words touched him, it actually, like, it helped me, you know, it gave me some healing, you know.
It really does, you know. I think we forget to talk about that as healers, as therapists. Like, we, our job can be, it's a very unique job, but it's, yeah, it's so rewarding. Yeah. It is so rewarding because of what we get to have an impact on other people's lives.
Right. And you know, the only way I could explain what it feels like, because somebody might be listening to this and be like, wow, I never felt that. Man, this is crazy. Maybe they like listening to it, but maybe the only best way I can explain it is just like having a dark cloud over you, right? So think about it. You know, people in Oregon, that the suicide rate is so high up there, you know, and when just because of the weather, you know,
yes,
the and it rains.
Seasonal affective disorder, that's a real thing. It's sad. It stands for seasonal affective disorder because of the weather. No sunlight. It's just so dark.
It just, that's how I felt. I felt there was a dark cloud over me every single day. And you know, and that's the only way. Just thinking about it, it was just horrible. You know, now I just.
So how do you view that dark cloud now? Is it gone?
It's gone.
Awesome.
Like, you know,
that's
so like today, today, Sonia, it was raining. It was dark. There was a dark cloud. It was no sun out, but I was happy, man. I embraced the rain. You know, I was like, man,
you know, that's one of the things, like when we want to switch our moods, right, from when we're feeling really depressed, is getting into gratitude.
Yeah,
man, I know. Again, when you start thanking God or the universe or whatever you believe in, right, and you have that attitude of gratitude and you're really thanking, like, for every single thing,
right,
and you're not just randomly like naming things, you're really being intentional about like what you're thankful for, it changes your perspective, it changes your mood right away, it releases those good hormones right away. Yeah, gratitude, I think, is another thing. And it seems like you've been able to get into that.
Yeah.
That's helped you.
And just speaking, being positive, just trying to speak, you know, because you are what you put out sometimes, you know. You're going to be so negative and bringing out that
you're
gonna
get
energy.
It back.
And you're just talking about this person all the time. You're always complaining about this situation. Oh, my girlfriend this, or my wife that, or my husband this, and every day I'm like, you just, this person got to listen to this like negative, like and then you bring that person in your world and it's like, man, that's the reason why I tell people, like, man, look, man, like, I can't be around that, you know. I was that at one time, but what I'm saying is, like, I now I have to hang out with people that are like-minded, people that just speak positive, you know.
That's self-love. That's you getting to a place of self-love and having boundaries, very healthy boundaries for yourself, that you won't put yourself around certain people.
Now, if I have a friend that's going through that, of course I'm going to be there for them and give it some great advice. But if I'm going to keep hearing it every single day for a year, like, man, I'm gonna be like, look, man, you really need some therapy, you know. You need to hook up with my girl Sonia, man, you know.
It's like my friend Ahmed says, go to therapy, right? Hashtag go to therapy.
Yeah.
Because a lot of people really do. I think we all need it. We all could benefit, you know, from a really good therapist, just because there's things that they don't teach us growing up, you know, like how to freaking communicate or navigate conflict, or like be in touch with our emotions, or have empathy, or, you know, break free from generational trauma, like all kinds of stuff that we don't get taught. So,
You know, for me, it's conversation. Like, this is why I wanted to do a podcast, because like conversation is very important. Than being on a cell phone and texting a friend, you know, like whatever, what happened with getting on the phone and checking in with somebody. I think that's the reason why having a therapist is good, because you get that one-on-one conversation. You get to communicate and you get to, you know, for me, that, man, that always helped me, Sonia. Like, so, like, it's not the medication. It was, I always you know, I just wanted to share. Like, I just want to share. Like, yeah. And, you know, but, you know, I was doing it wrong because I was sharing it with the wrong people sometimes. It could be somebody who don't care to listen. It could be somebody who would just take what you're saying and gossip about you. Like, like I mentioned to you at your on your podcast, where it's like, no, you need that one person that you could trust. And always just that one person and that one person. And that's it. You know, and if you don't have that one, then get yourself a therapist, right?
Then get yourself a therapist. Right. Yeah, I think because it becomes a place where it's very non-judgmental, and a lot of people really have a hard time getting real honest with themselves.
Yeah.
You know, like really looking at themselves and getting real.
Yeah.
It's very hard for people to do. So, being with someone who's non-judgmental and doesn't really know you sometimes can be easier for some people, you know, and sometimes that's why people do go to, you know, seek a therapist. But I'm all about healing and using whatever modalities to work for people, you know, it all looks different.
Yeah, no, I agree. Man, Sonia, this was great. I enjoyed this conversation, and I know somebody's going to be, you know, touched by what we're talking about. You know, I believe that some seeds were planted today. Now, if somebody wanted to reach out to you, where can they find you?
So I have I run my own virtual private practice. So you can find me. It's www.soniagilfuslcsw.com. And I'll spell that. It's www.soniagilfoslcsw.com. That's a long one. And then, it'll tell you everything on there too. I share a lot of information about brain spotting, and then there's information on there also about our podcast, and that I would highly recommend, you know, like anyone who's struggling with anything with mental health, go listen to those episodes on Con Amor, Your Therapist Friend, because you get a little bit of everything, you know. And again, like I said, we record in English and in Spanish, and it all deals with mental health.
Awesome.
And the Con Amor, Your Therapist Friend, we're available on all podcast platforms.
Nice.
Yeah, thank you, Jaime. I don't know what to call you ever. I'm like, Jaime Lyrics.
You know what? It's cool either way, you know.
Thank you.
Knowing that, if you know, for you to call me Jaime, you're a friend of mine, you know. Lyrics, same thing, you know. I got friends that I just, you know, like my buddy JT Campos, he calls me Jaime Lyrics, you know, or Robert Lizardo, he calls me Jamie, he calls me Jaime, he calls me Lyrics, you know what I mean? So I think that's pretty cool too, you know.
I think that's where I'm at. I'm like, Jaime Lyrics. Yeah, it's like both Jaime Lyrics
or Lyrics 559. It's cool either way, man. The fact that you know my name, you're paying attention, and yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah, I love what you do. I think you're so talented in so many different ways, and I love your heart.
Thank you.
Know, for people and for you know, the kiddos that you work with. Yeah, it's like a healthy masculinity, right? Which we actually just recorded an episode on that. But Lyrics, good job. I'm proud of you too.
Thank you. No, I'm proud of you as well. So y'all check her out, man. Con Amor, Your Therapist Friend. And thank you so much, Sonia.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Man, I thought this segment was pretty dope. I hope you guys got some out of this. Again, if you have any questions, and maybe you could hit her up, maybe consult with her or something. If you're looking for a therapist, hit up Sonia. Nah, man. Always hook up with somebody, maybe a good friend that could listen to you, that won't tell your secrets and won't put you on blast. You know what I mean? Don't be telling. Don't get a friend like Yolanda. You know what I mean? Might snitch you out and get some money for it. Nah, I'm just playing, man. Much love, man. Thank you again. Much love, Sonia, man. I appreciate you, man. Thank you so much. Check out the song One Life by me, your boy, Lyrics. Come on now. Stream it. Bump it in your trunk.
Clear Music Productions.
not giving up. I bet your child who was rough. I know how hard it is for you to love, too hard to give a hug. I bet you feel like a black sheep. What the hell with my family? You don't want to live, but you're talented and you got so much to give up. Hey, you only got one life. Let me give you advice. Now if your body's gonna be your friend, nobody wanna see you win. So let me see you smile, my G, because this world ain't gonna pause due to your mind disease. So put your mind at ease. Let's get it cracking like a pile of leaves. Let's get it.
Only got one life. I'ma live it positive. Only got one life. I'ma make it to my.
That breeze,
yeah.
But can you see it?
Nope.
But you believe it,
yeah.
But it's gonna take time to achieve it. But it's gonna be perfect, you gotta lose before you win. So take that L, man, and raise that chin. Cause it's your time to speak with existence. Walk in faith, don't be tripping. God is good, you gotta consider it pure joy. Out the hood, and I'm ready to deploy. And you could do that too, be that dude. If you get mad, don't be that rude. So live your life, Cuddy. You only got one. You lose it, you're done. Hey, but I know you're gonna make it. It's the same book but different pages.
Only got one life. I'ma live it positive. Only got one life. I'ma make it do my thing. Only got one.
Clear Music Productions.
Light comes, light comes.